Yeah, everyone evacuate. Jesus.
Flying Like Iron Man returns, the project you've all been waiting for.
A few of the guys convinced me that if we crack 100,000 subscribers, we should try and recreate this scene from Iron Man.
In 3, 2, 1.
But let's be honest, it's probably gonna look more like this.
One.
You know the drill. I promised the internet something stupid, and now we have to deliver.
A big thank you to everyone who supported the GoFundMe campaign. In 1 year, we raised $3,600 out of our $75,000 goal. Unfortunately, it's become very apparent that we're not going to be able to use crowdfunding to support the Flying Like Iron Man project. And as such, we've shut down the GoFundMe campaign and will not be asking for any more donations.
T-shirts, t-shirts, get your t-shirts here. Help make sure the Hacksmith channel doesn't go under, since we do really expensive projects and we don't really think about it.
However, we're not giving up. I promised the internet I was going to fly, and I still intend to. Why haven't we posted any updates on the Flying Like Iron Man project in over a year? Well, we have, just not to YouTube. There have been posts on our Instagram page and our Facebook page and even our Twitter, which is another reason why you should follow us on those social platforms. But the funny thing is, if everyone who commented asking, "Where's this project? Why aren't you posting videos on it?" just donated $5, we would have broke our goal in a matter of weeks. And then we would have been able to continue the project. Anyway, with the $3,600 we did raise from GoFundMe, we were able to buy one of the 195mm Schubler EDFs, able to produce 24 kilograms of thrust. Wait a sec. $3,600, and a Schubler costs $6,500. Unfortunately, these EDFs have a very long lead time. We ordered one, but we won't be getting it until around February 2018. So until then, we're going to be working on different aspects of the project. But we are hoping to have about one video per month on the Flying Like Iron Man project. So, if we're shutting down the GoFundMe campaign, how are we going to afford to continue this project? Well, instead of continuing the project from a year ago, which many of you guys asked us to, we decided to put on the back burner and focus on growing our YouTube channel and our business instead. And it's worked. In the past year, we've grown our YouTube channel by over 1 million subscribers and over 70 million views. In fact, we're in the top 50 channels in all of Canada. That's insane. We have an awesome facility and great people on the team. In fact, we have 4 full-time employees here, a few part-timers, and we even have high school co-op students. What we're doing here is really unique. I don't think there's ever been a case of an engineering company that's been born on YouTube. Until now. And that's us. And now that we've gotten to the size that we are, it's a lot easier for us to get sponsorships. So our plan to finish the Flying Like Iron Man project is to fund it fully through the videos, through sponsorships. Like this video sponsor, War Robots. Did you know you guys can help support this project without spending a dime? All you have to do is click on the link in the description below and play a free game. War Robots is an awesome tactical 6v6 multiplayer robotic warfare game. There's an absolutely huge variety of specialized robots, so you can find the gameplay style that fits you. For me, it's the robot called Hover. It's as if we merged the Flying Like Iron Man project with the exoskeleton and loaded it with an absurd amount of weapons. It is a glorious, flying, killing machine. With the amazing 3D graphics and constant updates with cool new stuff, it's no wonder over 70 million players have already installed the game. Download War Robots via my link below and get a special, massive bonus of the GI Patton robot and a unique skin for it, 4 Punisher machine guns, 100 gold, and 400,000 silver to spend on whatever upgrades you want. With this offer, you'll have a pretty big advantage when you start playing. But now, back to the project. Go ahead and click the link in the description below and try War Robots for free. If enough people sign up, we'll be able to afford one of these. A frickin' jet engine. Wait, a jet engine? I thought you were using EDFs. Well, that's the plan, but jet engines have way more thrust. Yeah, but you can't control them accurately. How are you going to hover stably? Well, if we use a hybrid system of jet engines and EDFs, we should be able to hover and have enough thrust. I don't know why you're explaining this right now. People have stopped watching. You're talking too much. You're right. So as you guys know, For a while, we've been saying, no jet engines, don't use jet engines. And that's because there's quite a few cons to using jet engines. There are pros, though. A jet engine has far more thrust than an EDF. You get a longer flight time because you can store more gas on your back than you can lithium polymer batteries. And they're smaller than EDFs. So it'll be just like flying like Iron Man rather than maybe something like flying like Vulture. But there are some issues with using jet engines. One, you can't control them accurately like you can with an EDF. If you put four jet engines in a square, you couldn't make it hover because fine-tuning each of those to be able to hover just isn't possible. Number two, the exhaust coming out of a jet engine is over 800 degrees. That means we're back to the first problem we had using model rocket engines. We'd literally burn our skin off, down to our bone probably, if we got in the way of the exhaust. So that's another huge issue that we'd have to work around. But what if we did a hybrid system? If we used a few jet engines to provide most of the thrust to lift us off the ground, then we could use lower power EDFs around us in a drone shape and use a commercially available drone controller board to give us stable flight. Now that's an idea. Regardless, we're still very much in the engineering design phase. We're gonna have to get a jet engine and a good EDF in-house to do tests to see if our design is even feasible. The jet engine we're looking at right now is by King Tech? The jet engine we're looking at right now is called the the K310G. And yes, that stands for 310 newtons of thrust. That's almost 70 pounds of lift. That's huge. And it's only slightly bigger than the Schubler 195 millimeter EDFs. Right?
Might be smaller.
Actually, it might be smaller. It's skinnier, but maybe longer. I don't know. Plus, you can get even bigger jet engines that put out hundreds and hundreds of pounds of thrust that aren't that much bigger. The issue is cost. We looked at some of these, and they can cost upwards of $50,000 each, which is crazy. But wait, Hacksmith, hasn't Richard Browning already flown successfully, like Iron Man, using jet engines? Aren't you just copying him now? Well, to be fair, my videos came out first, almost a year before his first video came out. So if anything, I think he copied me. Nah, he didn't copy you. He's been working on this in secret for years and years. Well, maybe, but I did it first on the internet, and that means I did it first. Okay there, buddy. Anyway, while it's true that Richard Browning has already successfully flown like Iron Man using jet engines, like we're maybe going to do, there's a few issues that we see with his design. And the biggest one that sticks out to us is his lack of control. Basically, it relies completely on pilot skill to be able to fly. Which, while that is really cool, you do have to be a skilled pilot in order to use this super scary system, it's not really practical, especially if you're planning to commercialize it, which apparently he is. What we think would work better is if you had a hybrid system, like we mentioned earlier, where we have EDFs and jet engines to provide stable flight that you don't have to control. Because the big issue we see is, if he goes up too high in the air and he loses control, he's not saving himself. In fact, we've already seen this in a few of the videos that he's released. Besides, hybrid systems are already tried and proven. That's how the flyboard air works, which is one of the closest things to flying like Iron Man that we have right now. Have you seen it before? What I don't understand is why hasn't someone put an Iron Man costume on yet and used one of these? But wait, I thought you said you're gonna do your own EDF. Well, if you guys were following us on Instagram, you'd see that we've been working on one for the past half year, actually. And the reason we're able to do this is because we actually got a sponsorship from Solidworks. Now, Solidworks is the CAD software that both Ian and I have been using for over a decade. It's basically one of the industry standards for mechanical engineering CAD. And they gave us the full package. We even have simulation software, which will allow us to determine if our EDF design will actually put out enough thrust. Thank you. The electrical tape blew off.
The simulation says we should get about 250 newtons of thrust from this design. But unfortunately, that is just a simulation, so we're gonna have to actually test this. And to do that, we're gonna have to build a thrust test jig. All right, hit it.
It's working! It's working!
All right, just kidding. That is not our test rig. So what we need to do is build a thrust test rig that is capable of measuring several things. The RPM of the motor, the input voltage, the input current, and obviously the thrust output by the EDF blade. Oh, and the input throttle. And we need to log it all so we can graph it later. Both Bogdan and Benjamin have been working on this thrust test jig for a few months now, and we're actually going to explain it in more detail in a future video. So we're outside the shop, and we're about to test our custom, completely in-house designed 20-inch... Is it 20 or 24?
20.
20. 22. 20? 20-inch EDF. So we had to outsource this to Autotiv because in-house we only have the FDM printers, which, as you saw in our previous videos, just didn't hold up to the test that we did last time. So this is actually printed with a process called SLS, or Selective Laser Sintering. And this is actually nylon powder that's been fused into that shape. And then we actually printed the duct ourselves, so that's 8 individual pieces all screwed together, and then epoxied using ecstasy resin. Bogdan's created this little thrust test jig, and what we'll actually be able to do is measure the thrust output from this fan blade and this motor. So to power this, we're actually using a 150cc gas engine replacement motor sold by Hobby King. It's roughly around 10 kilowatts, which is a crazy amount of power in such a small form factor. It should be fairly strong, but we're gonna test it and see if it explodes. But big shout out to Autotiv for providing us with this part. They have tons of other 3D printing technologies that you just can't get in-house. So I believe the simulation said we should be getting around 30 kilograms of thrust out of this. So if we can get that, then that means we know that the SOLIDWORKS simulations are correct, which will allow us to redesign the blade and optimize it. Woo! Controller?
Welcome to OpenTX.
All right, so our initial test is just going to spin it up to about 20 or 30%. We don't want to push it right away because there is a good chance this propeller is just going to explode. And when we go up to 100%, I want to be really far away.
Whoop. Throttle 30% max.
So that means if I go all the way to the top, maximum power is still 30%. If we flick it to third position, that's 100%. So we don't want to do that. So middle position.
Throttle 30% max.
Let's do it. Oh my god. Jesus. Alright, you guys realize how dangerous this flying like Iron Man project really is. Did you hear how loud that was?
Disarm it. Make sure you disarm it.
Okay. That looks good. Motor is cold. Speed controller is cold. I didn't like that noise though. Can you imagine 6 of these on my back?
Throttle 30% max. Throttle on.
Alright, so we've turned the controller on to give us full 100% throttle. We're only going to go up to 50. We'll see what happens, see how we're feeling, and then continue from there. Oh boy. I'm not standing in front of it. Oh. I don't know about that. That's 50%! I feel like we're building a friggin' jet engine. She still hasn't blown. It looks fine, like looking at it. Okay, ready?
Throttle 30%.
All right, this is 30%. Yeah, everyone evacuate.
What about you?
All right, everyone, two safe distances. All right, so we're going up to 30% again. That's 30%.
30%.
Unlocking full throttle.
60, 70, 80, 100. The entire neighborhood can hear us. The entire neighborhood.
I can't hear you.
Whoa, cut the throttle.
Motor's hot.
Right.
Motor's burning a bit.
This guy down.
Speed controller, not too bad. Wires, not too bad. We can include this in the video too. Just a little clip, like we live streamed it.
Okay. Where did you put it? 5 kilograms.
Wow, 5 kilograms. Yeah. Woo. All right, so those initial numbers were pretty pathetic, but we've looked at the data now and plotted on a graph. So it's science time. For those interested, slow down the video to 1/4x speed.
As you see, based on the first graph, as I increase the throttle, we have both gradual and linear increase in both power draw, or current, and thrust output. At first, we only got 30% test stability and vibration of the EDF. During the entire test, we're unfortunately unable to hit RPM, which is the green line. Data passed a certain point. The Hall effect sensor is low enough position. Upon reaching around 25% throttle, you can see it reducing again rapidly as the loud hum begins. Past that point, the noise of the thrust axis is much higher, likely due to turbulence. That also causes a hum. You see, as the blade spins up, it creates vortexes of air, known as turbulence. And that can often interfere with the upcoming blade. This is known as prop wash, and is often responsible for increased efficiency. We believe this may be a cause of such low performance, as we quickly see the current draw catch up to the thrust produced at an exponential rate. If the efficiency were to stay constant, as before the vibration, we can see in the bottom graph that our predicted thrust output may have reached 18.4 kilograms, roughly what we originally anticipated based on our calculations in simulation software.
So the TLDR of that is we need to do a lot more testing, which we'll be doing in a future video. But regardless, we're actually really happy with that test because the part didn't explode, which is really impressive considering it was 3D printed. Well, that's all for this update. We're gonna try and have an update on this once a month. But big thank you to all our supporters on GoFundMe. You guys allowed us to buy one of those Schubler 195mm EDFs to test out. And a big thank you to our video sponsor, War Robots, which will hopefully allow us to buy a jet engine to test as well. And if you guys want to support the project, we're selling some limited edition Hacksmith t-shirts that you can buy to help support this project. Show your support by buying one. There's a link in the description below. Thanks for watching and make sure you're subscribed. You're not going to want to miss this.